Okay, so good morning everyone. Today we continue with our book club on the fundamentals of diagnostic radiology with the chapter on the liver, biliary tree, and the gallbladder with your colleague Dr. Saad. She's gonna try to summarize the whole thing in maybe 40-45 minutes because it's a long chapter. You may start.
Good morning. Our chapter today is about liver, biliary tree, and gallbladder. Liver. Imaging methods, CT, MR, and ultrasound are produce high quality images of the liver parenchyma. Dynamic villous contrast enhanced multi-detector CT is the current method of choice for the most hepatic imaging. Fast imaging techniques that control motion have increased the role of MR as a problem solver and often as the primary hepatic imaging modality. Ultrasound is used as screening method for patients with abdominal symptoms and suspected diffuse or focal liver disease. Color flow and spectral Doppler are used to assess hepatic vessels and tumor vascularity. Radionuclide imaging is used in the characterization of cavernous hemangiomas and focal nodular hyperplasia. Multi-detector CT of the liver is performed using a three-phase or four-phase protocol of multiple scan of the entire liver. Initial non-contrast images are followed by rapid bolus IV contrast injection by a mechanical injector. Immediate images are optimally obtained during peak hepatic arterial enhancement phase to detect hypervascular tumor and other lesions supplied primarily by the hepatic artery. Arterial phase enhancing lesions such as hepatocellular carcinoma are high attenuation on a background of low attenuation minimally enhanced parenchyma. Maximum enhancement of the liver is attained during portal venous phase to demonstrate hypovascular lesions as low attenuating masses on background of brightly enhanced parenchyma. Because about two-thirds of the hepatic blood supply comes from the portal vein, maximum enhancement of the liver parenchyma occurs at 60 to 120 seconds following hepatic artery enhancement. Further delay images are obtained several minutes after contrast injection to document late contrast fill in of hemangioma and delayed enhancement of cholangiocarcinoma. Hepatic MR imaging is performed with a broad array of fast spin echo, breath hold gradient recall, short time inversion recovery, fat suppressed, and in phase out of phase pulse sequence. The goal is to maximize the lesion detection by using the streaking contrast resolution of MR while minimizing motion artifact by rapid scan breath hold sequences. Dynamic contrast enhancement is achieved with MR by repeating full liver scan multiple times in the first minute following gadolinium injection. Two major classes of gadolinium-based contrast agents are in use, extracellular agents such as gadopenitate, dimeglumine. The liver-based contrast agents such as gadoxetate, sodium.
There are two contrasts in the MRI in the liver. There are extracellular, that's the normal contrast. They only use it for the brain and soft tissue masses and everything. And there is the intracellular. The intracellular contrast, what's special about it, it's taken up by the hepatocytes, okay, and stay inside the cell, okay? So what when there is a lesion, if it takes the contrast, means it's the normal liver cells, okay? The lesion that's abnormal, like for example metastasis, will not take contrast. It's the opposite of the usual story. Usually the lesion takes the contrast and the normal cells not. Here it's the opposite. The normal cells take the contrast, the lesion is not. Okay, next.
Diffusion-weighted MR has emerged as a method of hepatic lesion detection and characterization in patients who cannot receive IV contrast. MR spectroscopy is used for quantitation of liver fat infiltration and other diffuse hepatic disease. Ultrasound used as a rapid screening modality for disease of liver, biliary tree, and gallbladder. And fine needle aspiration for cytology and core needle biopsy for histology. Kino segment.
I think we are familiar with the liver segments, yes. Right? We might proceed to the pathology.
supply to the liver is approximately 2/3 via the portal vein and 1/3 via the hepatic artery. When IV contrast is administered as a bolus during rapid CT scanning, the maximum liver parenchymal enhancement will be delayed by 1 to 2 minutes following initiation of injection. This delay reflects the transient time of contrast agent through the GI tract and spleen before accessing the liver through the portal vein. Tumors which are supplied primarily by hepatic artery will enhance maximally during the early hepatic arterial phase, whereas the liver parenchyma enhances maximally during the portal venous phase. Perfusion abnormalities are seen on post-IV contrast CT and MR because of variation in the hepatic arterial and portal venous blood supply to various areas of the liver. The dual blood supply has compensatory relation. Arterial flow increases when portal venous flow decreases, and increased portal venous flow compensates for decreased hepatic arterial flow. Transient enhancement differences are seen during either arterial phase imaging or portal venous phase imaging on multi-detector CT and dynamic MR. These abnormalities have been determined transient hepatic attenuation differences or transient hepatic intensity differences. Portal venous flow may be altered by first portal blockade by tumor or thrombus, extrinsic compression caused by the ribs or diaphragmatic split, or tumor on the liver capsule. Third inflow from the sphenic veins in the pericholecystic, parabiliary, and epigastric paraumbilical venous systems. Systemic venous blood flow and blood drains into hepatic sinuses, altering normal intrahepatic blood flow. This results in focal area of increase or decrease enhancement during various phases of parenchymal enhancement. Hepatic arterial flow may be also increased by focal hypervascular lesions, inflammation of adjacent organs like cholecystitis, pancreatitis, aberrant hepatic arterial supply. Regional differences in blood supply related to these factors explain the patterns of enhancement abnormalities as well as altered pattern of diffuse liver disease such as fatty focal deposition and focal fatty sparing in diffuse fatty infiltration. On CT, the attenuation of normal parenchyma is equal to or greater than the attenuation of normal splenic parenchyma on an enhanced image. Following bolus IV contrast administration, the normal parenchymal enhancement is less than that of the spleen during arterial phase and equal to or greater than that of spleen during portal venous phase. On MRT1 weighted image, the normal liver is of slightly higher signal intensity than the spleen, and most focal lesions appear as low intensity defects. With T2 weighted image, the normal liver is less than or equal to the spleen signal strength, and most lesions appear as high intensity foci. This is perfusion defect.
See this perfusion defect here. It's not, it looks like a lesion, but it's not a lesion. It's just a difference in the perfusion.
Hepatomegaly. Enlargement of the liver is usually judged subjectively on imaging studies. Rounding of the inferior border of the liver and extension of the right lobe of the liver inferior to the lower pole of the right kidney are evidence of hepatomegaly. A liver length greater than 15.5 cm measured in the midclavicular line is considered enlarged. Radial lobe is normal variation of the hepatic shape found most often in women. It refers to elongated inferior tip of the right lobe of the liver. When a radial lobe is present, the left lobe of the liver is correspondingly smaller in size. The left lobe of the liver may, as a normal variant, be elongated and surround a portion of the spleen. Fatty liver. Hepatic steatosis is the most common abnormality demonstrated by hepatic imaging. It is prevalent in 15% of general population and 50% with hyperlipidemia or high alcohol consumption, and up to 75% of patients with severe obesity. Causes are many, but two of the most common are alcoholic liver disease and non-alcoholic fatty liver disease related to the metabolic syndrome of insulin resistance, obesity, diabetes, hyperlipidemia, and hypertension. Other causes include viral hepatitis, drug specialist steroids and chemotherapy, nutritional abnormality, radiation injury, cystic fibrosis, and storage disorders. All conditions injure hepatocytes by altering hepatocellular lipid metabolism with defect in free fatty acid metabolism, resulting in accumulation of triglyceride within the hepatocytes. Fatty liver is initially reversible, but may progress to steatohepatitis, cell injury, inflammation, and fibrosis, with further progress to cirrhosis. Non-alcoholic fatty livers include a continuum of the liver disease that extend from simple fatty liver through non-alcoholic steatohepatitis to cirrhosis. And diagnosis by liver biopsy showing inflammation and fibrosis in addition to hepatic steatosis. Patients are at risk for this increasing common condition, including those with type 2 diabetes and metabolic syndrome. Cause of hepatomegaly in this table. On ultrasound, the normal liver parenchyma is equal to or slightly more echogenic than the renal cortex and spleen parenchyma on an enhanced CT. Comparison of CT and ultrasound findings may yield the diagnostic flip-flop sign, with fatty liver being dark on CT and bright on ultrasound.
So it's the opposite of the normal. Normally, the liver should be less bright on ultrasound than the spleen. Mm-hmm. When there's fatty liver, it will be more bright than the spleen, because fat is hyperechoic, okay?
Yes.
And on the CT, it's the opposite. So flip-flop, everything is opposite, okay? Skip to the next one, please. Next slide. Yes,
this is
on the images.
Yes.
What do you see here?
This is normal liver.
Okay.
Showing portal trait and clear diaphragmatic outline and low echogenicity.
Okay.
But the other.
You can appreciate the increased liver echogenicity first, and you can see the difference between the liver and the diaphragm.
Yes.
On the normal side, the diaphragm is very well seen as a bright echogenic line, because the liver is of normal echogenicity. When the liver echogenicity increases, becomes hyperechoic, the diaphragm is less obvious. And with the increasing severity of the fatty infiltration, the diaphragm becomes less and less obvious. Sometimes you cannot even see it, okay? Next. Again, what do you see here?
Diffuse fatty liver.
And the liver.
Yes.
So, this is diffuse fatty liver on the, what? This is negative image, sorry. This is negative image. The dark is, the white is black and black is white. So, when the spleen is dark, it means on the real thing is it's white. Okay? It's confusing image. Just skip it.
Characteristic features of fatty deposition on all modalities include lack of mass effect, no bulging of the liver contour or displacement of intrahepatic blood vessels, and angulated geometric boundaries between involved and uninvolved parenchyma. Areas of fat deposition may be multifocal with interdigitating fingers of normal and abnormal parenchyma. Fatty changes can be developed within 3 weeks of hepatocyte insult and may resolve within 6 days of removing the insult. Pattern of fatty infiltration are strongly related to hepatic blood flow.
So for the young residents, that's the most important thing here, is to differentiate between diffuse fatty liver, focal fatty liver, and focal fatty sparing. Sometimes the whole liver is involved, except small area. You need to be careful. This is not a disease. This is just an area of a spare from fatty infiltration, okay? There is no mass effect, there is nothing, everything is normal vascularity in its place, no invasion, no destruction, no nothing. Just area of different echogenicity or different density. This indicates focal fatty sparing. The same thing, focal fatty infiltration. The whole liver is normal, just an area of increased echogenicity. The most common site for this fatty sparing involvement is the gallbladder bed. So you commonly see it there. Okay, that's the most important thing to differentiate from all the topic of fatty liver. Okay. Yes.
Diffuse fatty liver involving the entire liver is the most common pattern.
Yes.
acute hepatitis, most commonly cause no abnormalities on hepatic imaging. In some patients, diffuse edema lowers the parenchymal echogenicity and causes the portal venules to appear unusually bright on ultrasound. In acute acute fulminant hepatitis, areas of necrosis show as ill-defined area of low density on CT. Chronic hepatitis is characterized pathologically by portal and perilobular inflammation and fibrosis. Causes include chronic viral infection, hepatitis B and C. Imaging studies are insensitive to early pathologic changes. Fatty changes are minimal and liver is usually not enlarged. Perihepatic lymph nodes are commonly visualized. Ultrasound may show a subtle course increase in hepatic echogenicity. The primary role of imaging patients with chronic hepatitis is to detect hepatocellular carcinoma. Core biopsy of the liver parenchyma, often guided by ultrasound, is used to stage the disease. Cirrhosis is characterized pathologically by diffuse parenchymal destruction, fibrosis, with alteration of the hepatic architecture, and innumerable regenerative nodules that replace normal liver parenchyma. Causes of cirrhosis include hepatic toxins, infection, biliary obstruction, and hereditary Ligelson disease. A variety of morphologic alterations are seen on imaging studies. That includes hepatomegaly as early sign, atrophy or hypertrophy of the hepatic segmentus, coarsening of hepatic parenchymal texture, nodularity of the parenchyma, often on the liver surface.
This is what you need to look for if you are suspecting cirrhosis or cirrhotic liver process. You need to look for hepatomegaly, atrophy or hypertrophy of different segments. For example, the caudate segment might enlarge. You need to look for nodularity and of the liver, and for some coarsening of the liver parenchyma, the echo shadow. The caudate lobe should look for it, of course. And you need to look for enlargement of the periportal space more than 10 millimeter, reflecting. So this and any mild nodularity at the edge of the liver, the minimal sometimes, it is an indication of early cirrhotic process. Just be careful. The edge should be straight line, very straight. Any minimal nodularity, don't write cirrhotic process. Don't worry. Don't be afraid. Next. See the liver edge? It's minimal irregularity. This is. Someone might say, oh, I don't know, maybe normal. No, it's not normal. This is a cirrhotic liver. And then you can see the regenerative nodules in the liver, multiple. And here's the difficult thing, is to differentiate which one of these are hepatocellular carcinoma and which one is non-regenerative nodule. That's a really, really difficult job.
Extrahepatic signs of cirrhosis include the presence of portal systemic collaterals as evident of portal hypertension, splenomegaly, and ascites. Ultrasound demonstrates heterogeneous parenchyma with coarsening of the ecotexture and decreased visualization of small portal trait structures. High-frequency detailed scanning of the liver surface reveals fine nodules. Ecogenicity of the liver parenchyma is not significantly increased unless the fatty deposition is also present. CT may be normal in the early stages, or may reveal parenchymal inhomogeneity with patchy areas of increased and decreased attenuation. Fine or coarse nodularity of the liver surface is characteristic. MR show heterogeneous parenchyma signal on T1 and T2 weight. High signal fibrosis on T2 weighted image is the predominant cause of the heterogeneous appearance. Mimics of cirrhosis, yes, are conditions that cause diffuse hepatic nodularity or portal hypertension, including pseudocirrhosis of treated breast cancer, metastasis, miliary metastasis, sarcoidosis, schistosomiasis, Carey syndrome, nodular regenerative hyperplasia, and idiopathic portal hypertension. Nodules in cirrhosis, nodules are a constant feature of cirrhosis, and the challenge is to differentiate the benign nodule from hepatocellular carcinoma. Hepatocellular carcinoma may arise de novo or a stepwise process from the regenerative nodule to low-grade dysplastic nodule to high-grade dysplastic nodule to small hepatocellular carcinoma to large hepatocellular carcinoma. Regenerative nodules are the most common nodule composed primarily of hepatocytes that are surrounded by coarse fibrous septations. Small regenerative nodules less than 3 millimeters produce the micronodular pattern of serosis. Larger regenerative nodules more than 3 millimeters produce the macronodular pattern of serosis. Very large regenerative nodules up to 5 cm can mimic a mass. Regenerative nodules are supplied by the portal.
The whole idea is that regenerative nodules are liver cells, normal liver tissue, normal liver cell, supplied by the same blood supply of the liver, which is the portal vein mainly. Little, about 30% of the hepatic artery, and the rest is from the portal vein. So it does not enhance during arterial, it enhances during portal, like the normal liver. While metastasis or tumors, they take blood supply from the hepatic artery. So they enhance in the arterial and does not enhance in the portal. They make, it's washout, not done, it's not enhanced. Next.
Dysplastic nodules show foci of low-grade or high-grade dysplasia. Low-grade dysplasia nodules are not perimalignant and are supplied by the portal vein and show no arterial phase enhancement post-contrast. Low-grade dysplasia typically progress to high-grade dysplasia, and high-grade dysplasia dysplastic nodules show moderate atypia, have occasional mitosis, may secrete alpha-fetoprotein, but are not frankly malignant. They are, however, considered pre-malignant. High-grade dysplastic nodules receive increasing blood supply by the hepatic artery and show arterial phase enhancement. Overlapping the appearance of the small hepatocellular carcinoma, most dysplastic nodules have similar imaging characteristics and as regenerative nodules. They are indistinct and iso-intense to the liver on ultrasound, CT, and T1 and T2 weighted imaging. Dysplastic nodules are almost never hyper-intense on T2 weighted image, differentiating them from hepatocellular carcinoma. A rare infarction of dysplastic nodules result in high signal on T2 weighted image. Siderotic nodules are high in iron content and appear as a low signal nodules on both T1 and T2 images. The nodules may be regenerative or dysplastic, but are virtually never malignant. Small hepatocellular carcinoma defined as a less than 2 cm diameter overlap the appearance of high-grade dysplastic nodules. Detection leading to the treatment of small cell hepatocellular carcinoma is a major goal of hepatic imaging in cirrhosis. On T1 weighted MR, small hepatocellular carcinomas appear as a hypoechoic nodule with internal foci iso-intense to liver parenchyma. Fat contents within the nodule raises the risk of hepatocellular carcinoma. Fat contents within the hepatic nodule is best demonstrated by chemical shift MR in phase and out of phase imaging. On T2 weighted image, the nodules are of low intensity with foci of high signal intensity. High signal intensity on T2 image differentiates small hepatocellular carcinoma from dysplastic nodules. Small hepatocellular carcinomas show the hallmark finding of intense enhancement.
Is to see which one is enhancing the arterial phase. If I shift the enhancing the arterial phase, have hepatocellular carcinoma. Or back normal. Regenerative nodules. Okay, it's high-grade dysplastic nodule. But it's going to be carcinoma within a few days.
Pre-malignant.
The same thing. Okay.
On ultrasound, small hepatocellular carcinomas appear as a well-circumscribed hypoechoic mass in the cirrhotic liver. This appearance is not specific but should lead to CTMR for characterization. Mimics of hepatocellular carcinoma include non-specific arterial enhancing lesions and transient hepatic attenuation differences. The involved area is usually iso-intense to cirrhotic parenchyma on T1 and T2 weighted images. Hepatocellular carcinoma commonly becomes hypo-intense to the surrounding liver on delayed image, whereas these non-specific lesions are usually iso-intense on delayed imaging.
So, what you you should be aware of that there are some things that can look like hepatocellular carcinoma, which includes things like confluent fibrosis and portal hypertension, portal vein thrombosis. Each of these has its own pathological features and radiological features. Portal hypertension and portal vein thrombosis are very typical, have very typical findings. With portal hypertension, you see the splenomegaly, the collaterals, the cavernous transformation, and things like that. While portal vein thrombosis usually can be detected by ultrasound and portal vein Doppler, and you can see the thrombus within the portal vein and the no flow or slowed or decreased the flow. These are all mimickers of can look like something, things that can look like hepatocellular carcinoma. Okay, next.
But Chiari syndrome refers to the group of disorders characterized by obstruction to the hepatic venous outflow involving one or more hepatic veins. Hepatic venous obstruction causes increasing pressure in the hepatic sinusoids, resulting in the liver congestion, portal hypertension, and decreased hepatic perfusion. Diagnosis is urgent because of rapid progression of the liver dysfunction, hepatocyte necrosis, and cirrhosis. Causes include coagulation disorders, membranous web obstruction. And
what happens in blood carrier syndrome is that the hepatic veins get thrombosed, one of them or two or all of them. One, two, or three, all of them is blood carrier. One of the veins gets thrombosed, you have liver congestion, swelling, and marked ascites. You cannot have blood carrier syndrome without ascites. Lazm aqua ascites. Okay? Lazm aqua ascites. No ascites, no blood carrier. Okay? And you look for the vein by ultrasound, by CT, by MR, by whatever you like, all modalities can look for the hepatic veins and if they are thrombosed or not. What else do you have
here? We have passive hepatic congestion.
Passive hepatic congestion when there is heart failure, right-sided heart failure, it will cause the liver to congest, and when you inject contrast, then contrast will reflux into the hepatic veins. You see the hepatic veins, we've seen a few cases in the department now, you see the hepatic veins taking contrast. So this indicates you, if you see contrast refluxing into the hepatic veins, you should think of right-sided heart failure or congestive heart failure, okay?
Yes.
Like, for example, this is a blood carrier syndrome, I think.
Yes.
Yeah, you can see the filling defect in the hepatic vein.
Yes.
Okay? Okay, yes.
Hemochromatosis may be primarily resulting from the hereditary disorders that increase dietary iron absorption or secondary due to the extensive iron intake, usually from multiple blood transfusions or chronic disease, include cirrhosis, myelodysplastic syndrome, and certain anemias. MR is the imaging method of choice for this condition because of its high sensitivity and specificity. The susceptibility effect of iron best appreciated on T2 imaging causes loss of signal in tissue with extensive iron accumulation. The parenchymal pattern we have.
You have three patterns.
Yes.
Parenchymal pattern, reticular endothelial pattern, and renal pattern.
Renal pattern.
Okay.
Yes.
And you have primary and you have secondary hemochromatosis. Primary is primary. Secondary due to repeated transfusion, gematic thalassemia, or whatever. Okay. What you have is how to differentiate.
Spleen and bone not involved.
In the primary, the spleen is
spare.
Okay.
Bone and spleen.
So, if you see the spleen and the bone marrow normal with the liver hypointense, this indicates primary. If you see the liver, spleen, and bone marrow hypointense, this is secondary. Okay?
Yes. Gas in portal venous system. Signs associated with the bowel ischemia in adult, necrotizing enterocolitis in infant, less common cause including recent colonoscopy, enema administration, gastrostomy tube placement, abdominal trauma, inflammatory bowel disease, perforated gastric ulcer, necrotizing pancreatitis, diverticulitis, and abdominal abscess. CT reveals air in branching tubular structures extending to the liver capsule. Air is commonly evident within the mesenteric and central portal veins. Conventional radiography shows streaks of low density in the periphery of the liver. In distinction, air
gas,
in the biliary tree.
The gas in the portal venous system can be just benign findings, asymptomatic, not normal, but nothing significant, or can be very severe and life-threatening. So the trick first to detect the gas and to determine that it is in the portal, not in the biliary tree, okay? And the cause of the gas. Everything has its own cause. You can read it and you can see the difference here. The biliary tree, the one on the right side, okay? And the portal vein on the left side. The portal vein gas, you see it reaching to the periphery of the liver, to the edge of the liver, because blood is going to the edge of the liver, the portal vein. Biliary tree bile is going to the hilum of the liver. So you see it in the center of the liver, okay?
Liver mass. A major challenge of liver imaging is to differentiate common and benign liver masses such as cavernous hemangioma and simple hepatic cystis from the malignant masses such as metastasis and hepatoma. Ultrasound can definitely characterize hepatic cystis hemangiomas, but only with optimal technique. Benign and malignant solid masses overlap in sonographic appearance. CT can characterize most cysts and cavernous hemangiomas, but only with optimal techniques and multi-phase contrast administration. On MRI, simple cysts and hemangiomas are hypo-intense on T1 and extremely hyper-intense on T2 weighted image. These benign masses are typically homogeneous and have sharp outer margins. Malignant lesions on MRI tend to be inhomogeneous and unsharp outer margins. Peritumor edema and central necrosis, most focal lesions are hypointense on T1 weighted image and hyperintense on T2. Hyperintensity of focal lesion on T1 weighted image may be due to presence of fat, blood, proteinous material, or melanin.
First, you need to determine the number. Okay? Is it single or multiple? Okay? The echogenicity, if it's an ultrasound, or signal intensity, if it's an MRI, or density, if it is on CT, and you need to determine the enhancement. Okay, multiple liver masses. We have some lecture, I think, with the side group. Multiple liver masses equals the differential diagnosis of multiple liver masses. First metastasis, second metastasis, third metastasis, fourth metastasis. Okay. So let's do here. It's a metastasis. Next.
Metastasis.
Next.
Cavernous hemangioma.
Metastasis.
Is second only to the metastasis as the most common cause of liver mass. It is the most common benign liver neoplasm found in 7 to 20% of the population.
Yes.
Most common cause of multiple liver masses is metastasis.
The most common liver mass.
Mass, metastasis, common, and mythomagalvicular side, according to which book you read. Okay? Some will say hemangioma is more, and some will say metastasis is more. Both of them are common. Hemangiomas are hyperechoic, with a typical pattern of enhancement. Metastasis is usually hypoechoic, and with arterial phase enhancement. Okay? Common, metastasis or hemangioma, both of them are common. Which one is more? We need to make a study on that. We should send a bite.
According to the location, the hospital at the metastasis.
Blood flow through it extremely slow. Thrombosis within the vascular channels may result in central fibrosis and calcification. Most lesions are less than 5 cm in size, cause no symptoms, and are considered benign incidental findings. Large lesions, giant hemangiomas, more than 5 cm, occasionally cause symptoms by mass effect, hemorrhage, or... Hepatocellular carcinoma is the most common primary malignancy of the liver. Detection of the hepatoma on a background cirrhosis and regenerative nodules is a major imaging challenge.
Hepatocellular carcinomas are not very difficult to detect. Usually they occur on a background of a cirrhotic liver, usually. Common in patients with hepatitis B and hepatitis C and things like that. And you see a long history of cirrhosis and degenerating nodules. Whenever you have increased tumor markers, you should think of, especially alpha-beta protein, you should think of hepatocellular carcinoma. The trick is that it enhances on the arterial phase because it's a carcinoma. Wash out in the portal phase because it is a carcinoma. Okay? Next. Again here, portal venous thrombosis, multicellular carcinoma.
Multinodular.
So you can see the hepatocellular carcinoma as a diffuse process, infiltrative with portal vein thrombosis, as you see by the arrow, the big arrow. Okay, next. The classical and most common appearance of hepatocellular carcinoma is MRI is low signal on T1, high on T2, with arterial enhancement, venous washout. There. Next. Cyst, it's a very common. It's not a mass. Cyst is a cyst. Yeah, it's not a mass. Okay. Sometimes it can be difficult to differentiate it from a mass if it has some proteinaceous content, some internal debris, things like that. But usually it's common. Difficult to be differentiated from hydatid liver cyst, especially if it's small. No septations and no daughter cysts and no things like that. But they are common. Hydatid cyst, the wall will. But the if it is big enough, first, the small cysts are not that easy to see the enhancement. Second, the wall is not from the cyst. The wall is from the human body, the fibrous capsule. Mm-hmm. Okay? Of the liver, yes. It's the normal liver that enhances. The cyst does not, the cyst itself does not enhance. The fibrous capsule around it from the human body, the one that enhances. Okay? Menhidatin. What else? Bile duct hematoma. Low on T1 and high on T2, like everything else. Okay. Cystadenoma, cystadenocarcinoma.
Pyogenic abscesses.
And the abscesses. Okay.
Yes.
What else?
Hydatid cyst.
I think we have a very good experience with hydatid cyst.
Yes.
Every single one of us have seen at least maybe 1,000 hydatid.
Strange. Daughter cysts are found in 75%.
And again, Hassan will study according to where you read it. 75% of confirmed hydatid cysts. We see a lot of cysts. We consider some of them hydatid. Most of them we consider it hydatid, but we have no proof. Okay? I think this is talking about proved hydatid cysts. Okay?
Biliary tree. Ultrasound is preferred screening method for biliary obstruction because of its low cost, high accuracy in detecting biliary detection. However, ultrasound is limited by consistent visualization of the distal common bile duct and low sensitivity for determining the cause of obstruction. CT with or without contrast demonstrates biliary dilatation. An enhanced helical CT has a reported sensitivity of 88%. And MR also demonstrate biliary dilatation. MR, cholangiopancreatography provide excellent. مجموعة بس ال outline يعني.
Just go over the slide that. Next. Okay. What else? HIV associated cholangitis, pancreatitis, primary sclerosing cholangitis. Next. Bacterial cholangitis,
just a second.